Hey guys, this is Imp from Black Talon Gaming, and I'd like to welcome you to my review, and I guess first look, channel look at Stellaris. Paradox Interactive's new Grand Strategy 4X, 4X Grand Strategy game. I kind of stumbled over that because it's like, okay, Paradox, if you've watched my channel at all, then you know I love Paradox games, I love Grand Strategy games. I also have I really love 4X games, everything from Civilization to Gal Civ to Fantasy 4X games. I can't get enough of them, no matter what genre they are. And I have been playing Stellaris for about 2 weeks now. I got it maybe a week after its launch. And in that whole time, I've just been really in love with the game. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a little bit about the game, what's different or what differentiates it from other 4X strategy games, and then some things at the final section, some things I'd like to see in the future with Stellaris updates. With that said, let's go ahead and take a look at Stellaris. I've been mostly playing humans so far, so we're going to be taking a look at my biggest human save is my 6th human nation or whatever. Or wait, hold on. Oh gosh, there we go. I saw the planets and it said like 4 and I was like, that's not it. And the cool loading screens. The art production is really good for a first run of a Stellaris franchise. So like, this is the first in the franchise, so I don't expect the art to be like really fantastic. I'm expecting a good bit from the art in Hearts of Iron 4, I believe we're on now. But yeah, let me go ahead and get down to it. So this is Stellaris, and here is my version of Earth. Stellaris is the first Paradox game where you start with a symmetrical start for every other quote-unquote competitive empire. And I say competitive because there are two and probably going to be more exceptions to this rule in the future. The two exceptions that exist right now are the first one is called a Fallen Empire, and these Fallen Empires are large empire groups that exist in the game at the start of the game. They're usually somewhere towards the rim or whatever, for whatever reason they seem to spawn there. And they are very large, they are technologically advanced, they pose a significant threat to you if you attack them. However, if you do not mess with them, they're usually pretty copacetic, so I try not to mess with them. At the same time though, they're not really receptive to diplomatic stuff like that. So long story short, big empires, very powerful, but they're kind of just neutral parties out there, and they'll only come after you if you mess up, more or less. The other exception to the rule is primitive civilizations, which are found on individual planets. They're not yet developed to the point of spaceflight, and you can interact with them in several different ways, and I'll talk about that later. So back to the core game, this is the first Paradox game where you have a symmetrical start, so every other nation, with the exception of those that are selected, or with the exception of a random assortment that are selected for quote-unquote accelerated start, every other nation in the game is going to start out pretty much the same as you, so it's going to be it's going to be a lot like Gal Civ 3 or, you know, even Civ 5 or what have you. It's going to be a race for colonization. That's the way I put it, and especially in the very beginning of the game, you want to race until you're large and your sectors are covering places and stuff like that. So you start out in a single system, and eventually through a lot of warfare, colonization, and diplomatic work with lesser advanced civilizations, you become something like this. And here's my United Nations of Earth, and you can see I control maybe, what is that, 10% of the galaxy? 15% maybe? I'm most certainly... I'm a rival to my whole faction, which is like this group here. We have a federation. We're a rival to whatever this is. And we definitely, I think, surpass this empire here. Though they are pretty powerful, these close Sorvian Imperial clans. Alright, so pretty much it's just like any other Forex game, and after you've gotten a certain point of expansion and a certain point of technological research, you're really, the only option you have left is war. And that is highlighted by the fact that directly or indirectly, the game's two victory conditions depend entirely upon war. And the victory conditions, if we go here... There we go. You can see that we, quite a long while from the domination victory, and that's just controlling 40% of all colonizable planets. And then conquest victory is by conquering or subjugating all other empires, and subjugating, of course, either means, you know, have them join your alliance or force them into stellar servitude. We did that with the Hive of Belovi early on. Like, I was up here, and I have a federation going on, right? And we attacked the Belovi, and the Belovi controlled all of this, like, right here. They were really big and powerful, and they were threatening the Undar. And we cut them down to size, and now they are a vassal of the Undar. We created a free Belovi state here, or Cephalofid state, so... There are two Cephalofid states, which is pretty funny. Yeah, so long story short, they only ultimately you're gonna have to go to war eventually, and that's really where the endgame lies. And I'm pretty sure they're gonna expand on this later on. And that's the basic of the game. That's the basics of the game. Of course, I've glossed over things like I mentioned technological research, and you know I like technological research as they've done it now. I think it could be more varied. Anyhow, so that's the nature of the game. Now let's talk about how the game really does differentiate itself from other 4X games in this genre. And for this, I'm going to be talking and comparing this game directly to Galactic Civilizations. The first thing, and I think the biggest thing, is that it uses Paradox's unique kind of real-time strategy system. It's a grand strategy game that is played in real time. And of course, if you're familiar with Paradox games use kind of like a clock mechanism. You don't have a turn per se, but every as often as you want, honestly, you can pause the game in order to issue new orders. So the game does really feel like it lives and breathes on its own, and there's I've had no lag whatsoever in the game so far. And in previous Paradox games, it's really good on lag. I don't ever have to worry about it, as opposed to say Galsif 3, where the fluidity of playing Galsif was broken up by in later games, especially on large maps. At later stages in the game just seems to slow down. I can remember one time I pressed in turn, and I went to make some food, and I was maybe gone 5 minutes, and I came back, and it still wasn't done processing the turn. This has none of that. You press go, and it just, you know, it takes off. And of course, you can either pause it, or you can turn up the speed really fast, so on and so forth. So it really does feel seamless. You can slow it down as much as you want, and I do that. I slow it down when I have to, especially when I'm monitoring war. And then I speed it up when I'm doing, fun, crazy stuff like exploring new planets and stuff like that. Let's see, where else does it? In another place that it... So it feels a lot more seamless than Galsif does. Another place that it really shines is the level of depth and detail that is available on this game. You have... in terms of technology and in terms of the choices that you make in order to, like, the types of technology, I'm sure they're going to expand on the technology tree in the future, in future games. But there are so many, like, comparing this game in terms of its level of depth and detail, and comparing Galciv 3, it's, like, not even fair. It's hilariously unfair, really. For an example, you see, you know, like, vast amount of nations. There's 1,000 stars in this galaxy. And you see here, I've got a bunch of small little principalities within my borders. And these are all subject nations, vassal nations. And very specifically, I would say 95% of these, because I'm a, like, I thought it was fun to do this, so I did it, is 95% of these is, like, I would encounter a less advanced race, and I would stick a observation post up on top of them, you know, orbiting their planet. And when you have an observation post, you have four options. You can passively observe them, and that gives you some science output. You can actively observe them, so you're abducting their cows, apparently, and mutilating things, doing all sorts of fun stuff that, you know, gray aliens are associated with. I love the little icon being a cow, dude. It's freaking awesome. But when you aggressively observe them, you, of course, gain more science than if you were to passively observe them. You can also technologically enlighten them, which is what I did because I thought I was a good guy or whatever. And you, when you technologically enlighten them, it takes an amount of time, and there's sometimes some events that trigger off with it. I had one group that I was technologically enlightening, and they discovered me or something, and I accidentally caused them. They were a nuclear-equipped civilization, so you have to really take into account, like, oh, like, what kind of civilization is this? They had the power to destroy themselves, and they did. It was quite a sad day when I destroyed the Nafirbabrins or whatever the fuck, or whatever the heck they were called. That being said, like, 9 times out of 10, technological enlightenment doesn't do anything too bad. Then you have a last option. If you choose unrestricted native studies, you can infiltrate their society in order to add it to your empire, you know, as a whole. I will say that I had done that with this group here, and you can see they absolutely hate me, even though they are my vassals or whatnot. They absolutely hate me. That's because they're fanatical purifiers. I have no idea what that even means. I really don't, but they fanatically hate me. They are my vassals, but at one point I was occupying their planet, and that was ridiculous because there was just so much animosity. They were, like, fermenting rebellions, and I was spending a lot of resources trying to keep them under my thumb. I think I probably could have stuck with it, but I decided it wasn't worth it at the time because I was preparing for war with the Belovi. And the first war with the Belovi wasn't as sure of a thing as, like, now wars are for me. Like, I took this empire, like, I cut them in half, like, pretty easily, dude. But anyhow, so I didn't want to have to deal with them, so I released them and just made them a vassal. And that's the point I'm trying to make, is that you can go to such an extreme level of detail and depth that you don't have in other 4X games. Another great example is the Belovi. I think I already mentioned this, when we went to war with them, after we conquered them or whatever, I essentially split their nation up into two groups. I split them into this first group, which was the Capehead Stellar Union, and they became a subconscious consensus, so they're democratic government or whatnot, and they ended up joining our alliance, so they became the fourth member of our alliance, and the other group just became a vassal of the Undar. Yeah, so, I mean, that's pretty awesome, honestly. And in terms of depth, another great... Well, I'll talk about that in a second, but there's just lots of different things you can do. Even the little things from selecting governors to manage your sectors. Like, there's just so much more depth in this game than there are other games. But of course, you make up for it in that, for example, Gauss Civ 3 has better graphics. You know what I mean? You can just come out and say that. Like, it's fun seeing the ships and building ships and construct, you know what I'm saying? Like that. But if they attempted this level of detail in the Gauss Civ 3 game, like, you'd need a massive supercomputer to, I don't even know, man. But yeah. The third way that the game really differentiates itself is that there is no campaign, there are no mission sequences that you have to go through, there are no campaigns that you have to go through. However, you do get situations and missions, and these are pretty fun, and they're randomized pretty much from game to game. Like right now, in this game, I'm studying a precursor group called the Erasians, and I am two missions away from completing that study. I'm not sure what it will do for me, but that's one of my main reasons that I've been continuing to explore and continuing to fund my science efforts, is because that exploration chain really interests me. I love reading the little stories about these Erasians and what happened to them. And in the case of the Erasians, apparently there was some sort of plague going on, and I really want to find out what happened to them. And then, in all honesty, I'm hoping there's going to be some big awesome reward once I complete this series of missions, this event chain. That would be really, really awesome, and if they don't have that, they should. But those are some of the three major differences that you're going to notice right off the bat. Okay, finally, there are some things that I feel that the game could do better than it currently is doing. I'm going to go over these in very short order, and that's only if somebody who, you know, if you're a dev and you're looking for things that you can improve on, I'm just going to go ahead and lay out what I think what could be improved really quick. Like, first thing is, I personally would like more depth to technology, and I know that y'all tried to stay away from having a technology tree. I'm kind of on the fence about it. I've played 7 games as the humans, and it really feels like every single human empire is absolutely the same. One of the things you should be doing is, like, a technological path of research should really, block off another path of research. Like, presumably, if we hadn't been able to find good hydrocarbons, or if hydrocarbons hadn't been as easily able to extract on this planet, then, like, maybe we would have been using steam power. I don't know. Like, I want to see some more variety among the technological playthrough, and I think that will make, like I said, I played 7 games, and they've all felt the same in terms of technology. The only way that I guess they really change is when I, you know, give them, like, communal trait and stuff like that. And even that is really cool, because I know that there are some technologies that are locked to different traits. I would definitely like to see more special technologies that pop up as a result of events or missions and stuff like that. I really like that idea that your past determines your future. Like, it kind of gives you a story to tell. Like, oh, our guys gained, you know, like, for example, you can gain the shards when you kill the shard creatures. You can gain the shard weapons. I want more of that kind of thing, because I want to be like, yeah, after the Great Shard War, we all became, like, our marines were outfitted with shard armor and stuff like, you know, like something freaking awesome like that. Yeah, okay, so that's research. The only other major thought that I've got right now about things that you can improve is if we, government. I think that, and I think maybe y'all know about this a little bit, like, it just feels a little bit weak right now. Like, every time I play as a human, I don't know, I just think that maybe there could be some expansion of, especially with non-autocratic government forms, there should be an expansion on how power is transferred. Like, you remember in Victoria 2 how you would have a say on different issues, and you could try to influence people up or down on different things, and then the resulting changes might have an effect on the election. Something like that. Like, I really want the elections and other kind of unique, non-autocratic government types to kind of to be a little bit more in-depth. And I definitely want more than just a freaking mission that you have to complete to get some influence. Because, I mean, that feels cheesy as hell, because I'm the same exact dude. Yeah, I know you get new ruler traits and stuff like that. That doesn't matter to me either, really. I don't know. Maybe give... Like, right now, each of the ruler traits kind of... I mean, sometimes I see them, sometimes I don't. Like... Yeah, it's hard to say. Like, maybe add another ruler trait, or like boost one of the ruler traits up so that's even more apparent that that's what your ruler is about. And like, when I see a bunch of rulers on the roster, I don't even look at their ruler traits. I look at their missions, because I'm like, okay, which one will grant me an easier pathway to getting the influence that I want right now? You know what I'm saying? So I don't even think about their ruler traits that much. So maybe boost the ruler traits up. Maybe even give some of the ruler traits, give us like special abilities or something like that. I don't know. Maybe the ability to recruit mercenaries or something. I know that kind of thing would come out with an expansion pack. But back to governments. Another thing is that some of the advanced governments don't feel like they belong as an actual government. Like, there's one where it's like a biological hive nation or something like that. And a government is a result of your social conditioning and social development, whereas a hive organism is a development of its biology. And you can't really cease being a hive. I guess you could. I don't know. I mean, it certainly wouldn't be as easy as changing government. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think there should be some differentiations, and certainly some races should not have a government per se as much as they should have a state of being. Like a hive, like the xenomorphs from the Aliens franchise or the arachnids from Starship Troopers, they're not going to ever have governments, and they're not ever going to change out of their hive unless, like, in both cases, quite literally, unless another force is acting upon them. Those are my only two concerns right now. I'm not really worried about anything else. Like, I like where the game is going. And most importantly, okay, so that kind of ends my critique of some of the flaws I've seen so far. Going back to you, if you're a prospective player and you're thinking about picking up this game, I've not seen any other major overarching flaws, and I want to reiterate that what flaws do exist, I do, like, especially, like, really rampant, not rampant, it's not rampant, but really overt bugs that we see, we know those are going to get fixed. Every Paradox game ships with bugs. That's just how it is. And usually about 2 updates into it, they're usually good with most of the bugs, with the exception of Victoria 2. Just don't play Victoria 2. Anyhow, but for every other Paradox games, 2 expansions in, it's good, and then they start on the DLC, and it just gets better and better and better. I don't know if there's a season pass for this game. If there is, I'm going to find it. I'm probably going to buy it, because I'm really excited to see how they expand upon this and what they do next. And my recommendation is a buy. If you are a fan of Paradox games, this is a no-brainer. Buy it. It is such a new and fun take on Paradox titles, whereas you have the symmetrical start and you don't have to worry about getting Poland into space. Poland is already into space. You just have to compete with pretty much everybody else on a level playing field. There are going to be, like, you can adjust it, but there are a couple other civilizations who might have a slight leg up. You'll be able to adjust that, so it's no big deal. If you're a fan of 4X games and you've never played Paradox titles, I would also recommend to buy it. It's not going to completely replace your want for a Galsiv or whatever else might come out or whatnot, but it works in such a different way that it will definitely be a competitor, and I could certainly see it overtaking Galsiv Like, I've already seen the first expansion for Galciv. I saw their Mercenaries expansion. And I played that for, like, 2 weeks or whatever, and then I grew bored of it, you know? This, I can definitely see how in two expansions it's going to be a completely different game, but just as thrilling and exhilarating. So, in either of those cases, it's a definite buy. If you've never played strategy games before, I honestly think this would probably be one of the easier Paradox games to get into and get started with. You're not going to be bogged down with too much minutia, and one of the cool things about symmetrical starts where you start small and you grow big is that the nature of starting small is that you don't have a lot to mansion, you don't have a lot to manage at first, and as such it's easier to get a hold of how the game operates, and it's easier to learn as you go. So if you've never played a Paradox game, it's also, I recommend that you buy it, and like, in all honesty, start with this and then go back to Europa Universalis or go back to Crusader Kings and see how those work, because I guarantee you, if you like this, you'll probably like those. Anyhow, guys, that's my review, and I guess a thorough examination of Paradox Interactive's Stellaris. I want to thank y'all for watching. Please like and subscribe and all that mess. And y'all have a great day. Peace out, guys.